Good afternoon. I want to welcome everyone to our announcement for the Saints Hall of Fame class of 2023. I'm Ken Trahan, general manager of the Saints Hall of Fame, and on behalf of our board of directors, some of them are here today. We appreciate you being here to cover this, and we also appreciate the people that volunteer. Most of all, we appreciate the New Orleans Saints and the organization for what they have done for so many years to perpetuate something that we thought was a really good idea a long time ago, to be able to present the history of the franchise in the most positive fashion imaginable. I also want to recognize our media selection committee members. Many of them are here today. They work really hard on this, and they care quite a bit. And we don't always agree on everything, but boy, they do a good job at coming up with the right solutions each and every year, and we deeply appreciate their input. Without any further ado, it's my pleasure to introduce the head coach of the New Orleans Saints, Coach Dennis Allen, introduce our inductee for this year. Dennis?
All right, appreciate you guys all being here. This is obviously a pretty cool thing, being able to actually introduce and be a part of the induction of a guy that I personally got to coach, spend a couple years with, and he's the epitome of what it means to be a New Orleans Saint and the type of players and the type of people that we bring into this organization. I'm just going to go through a few stats and kind of get some of this stuff out of the way, and then I want to talk about the player. But, you know, over his career, he played 133 games with 86 starts. He played here for five seasons. He had 256 tackles, nine interceptions, 163 return yards, and two defensive touchdowns and 68 passes defensed. Back in 2009, we went to the NFC Championship game, obviously, in 2006. We had a couple of subpar seasons, kind of middle of the road, average. And we made a few changes, and we felt like we needed to get better defensively, and we wanted to be more of an attacking, aggressive style of defense. And to be able to do that, you need corners that can go out and cover. And look, I don't even know if Jabari knows this, but we had brought in a guy by the name of Ron Bartel.
I know that.
6'1", 207 pounds. He ran 4.37. So looked the part, right? And that was really where our mind was at the time. Ron signed back with St. Louis, and we turned our attention to Jabari, and I'm excited that we were able to bring him in here, because look, Jabari was an undrafted free agent, came in, worked his tail off, and really developed himself. He's a self-made man and a self-made player. And that's probably the greatest compliment that I can give to somebody, in that, you know, when you look at what we're looking for right now, all our corners are 6 foot tall, big, long, but they come in all different shapes and sizes. And Jabari came in and was a tremendous addition to our team. I still don't know. I think he's got the best feet of any corner that I've ever seen. And we were just talking out on the field, and I used to talk about guideline guys and rules guys. You know, rules guys are guys that have to do everything exactly how you want them to do it, and guideline guys are guys that, you know, you kind of give them a little leeway, but you got to make sure they stay within the guidelines. And I'd say my initial thought was Jabari's going to be a rule guy initially, all right? But quickly I realized that he really was a guideline guy. It was giving some thoughts in terms of how to do it, all right, and then let him work his craft. But I'm probably more proud of this player, not in terms of the type of player that he was, but the type of person that he is. Just a great human being, a wonderful father, a tremendous friend, and well-deserving of this recognition into the 2023 class of the New Orleans Saints Hall of Fame. Jabari Greer. Love you, brother.
Thank you, DA. Coach, I really appreciate that. Congratulations to the other inductees. Really appreciate the opportunity to be able to share the stage with men who have devoted their lives and their crafts to making this, making the Saints organization what it is today. We stand on your backs and we jump off your shoulders, brother. We love it, you know. I am in awe and in gratitude and in like the utmost humility of what God has done in my life. When I had an opportunity after my time at the Buffalo Bills, I had three teams to visit. It was the Detroit Lions, the Cleveland Browns, and also the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. And each time I went to one of those visits, I called my wife, Katrina, and told her, hey, this is where we going. This is where we here. We gonna be a Brown, baby. We gonna be a Lion. And every time she would tell me, just wait. You know, just wait. And at the end of the Tampa Bay Buccaneer visit, I didn't have a place to go, and I didn't know what I was going to do. My agent called me and told me that New Orleans wanted to fly me in the next day. And so I flew in, and I remember taking a trip in the facility. I met Roman and I met Tracy, and I remember walking outside of the parking lot right before the museum was there. I remember walking outside the parking lot to go grab lunch. And I remember the distinct smell of my Little League mouthpiece. And as clear as I'm talking to you, I heard the voice say, if you come here, you'll be able to play like you're a kid again. And I can't explain it. And it allowed me to have peace about the decision of coming to New Orleans. And so I made the decision, and there was still a lot of apprehension about the history of some of the defensive backs in New Orleans. And this is something that, as a defensive back, I wanted to acknowledge. And so I remember training with some men, my uncle and my trainer, and I told them my apprehension. And they looked me dead in the eye and say, well, go and change it then. And so I look at how God has allowed me not only to be a part of this organization to win a Super Bowl, but to be here right now, to have left the city and to have still have the opportunity to be welcome into this building, to be welcome in front of you. I think in terms of success, I honestly feel like as players and as people, we make it when our usefulness as players or as employees, when that diminishes and the organizations and the people are still willing to invest in us, still willing to bring us around, and still willing to listen and to open up their hearts to us. And I think that through God's grace, I have the opportunity to have made it as a New Orleans Saint. I want to thank my mother for everything that you've done for me, Mama. As a kid, being 6 years old, having the dream of playing professional football, you have never, ever told me that I couldn't do it. You've always encouraged me. You've always been my number one supporter. You've always been screaming from the top. I can always hear you no matter what. And I want you to know, like, pouring into me that you are a reason why I'm here. And you're going to have to excuse me for a second because I do want to honor my wife, who is no longer here with us, to be able to love and raise our children, and to be able to hold on the pressure that many of these wives go through to make sure that their husbands, that their boyfriends, that whoever they love and they serve can go out there with a free mind and a free heart and play a game that they love to play is a opportunity, and it's a obligation that they don't necessarily sign up for, but they hold and they carry with grace and with strength and with love. And I know that my wife was the epitome of that. She allowed me to come out here and play freely. And I wish when I heard that I was inducted to the Saints Hall of Fame, I prayed more than anything that, you know, that she could hear me giving her the thanks and the honor that she deserved, because she held it down and she allowed me to be the player that I was, that I was. And ultimately, I want to thank my children for allowing me to lead and to love y'all. You know, there's not many times in which, you know, I get to, you know, we don't need to talk about football that much anymore. You know what I mean? So, like, sometimes I forget that I played ball, you know, until, like, moments like this where actually sometimes I feel like they don't even believe I played ball anymore. You know what I'm saying? But it's like moments like this. It's like, oh, yeah, you actually did used to play ball. And so I think that to be a father and to be in moments where you can allow your kids to see that anything's possible, you can be an example of a dream that came into fruition. Like, there have been a lot of people who have allowed me to be at this point right here. But what I would say is that no matter what you do, like, the opportunity is there. There's nothing that y'all can't do. And there's, through God's grace, like, y'all can walk in any room and command it. And I want to be there for y'all just like my mom and my dad was for me. So I thank y'all so much for this opportunity. I think that more than anything, my teammates and this organization have done nothing but create a winning atmosphere. And I love the way that they encourage players to come back. And not only that, there's a special relationship between players and the media in this organization. I loved hanging out with Doug, with John, with Ramon, you know, with Jeff and Mike, you know. I remember those Travis and Fletcher, you know what I mean? Like, hanging out. I think you Fletcher, right? Oh, yeah, right. Fletcher. I worked with Fletcher, actually. We worked a lot, WDSU, and I loved it, man. And so it's a special relationship. It is and I know that y'all have a really tough job to do, but I really want to thank y'all for the grace and the grace y'all showed me personally. Y'all were tough, but y'all were extremely fair. And there's sometimes y'all let me off the hook, and I appreciate that. I sure appreciate that. So that's all I have. Thank y'all so much.
Questions?
Yeah. I think that for me, I find it interesting, man, because I never thought that there was another way. Of course, I wanted to be drafted, but I remember being picked up by the Buffalo Bills on this big 15 passenger van. And seeing guys from Florida, from Arkansas, from, you know, having a guy from Tennessee. It was like 15 of us all playing for three spots. And I remember going to the hotel, and we were all rookies, all undrafted. And I remember saying to myself, like, there's no way that everybody's going to make this team. Like, somebody's not going to make it. But it ain't going to be me. You know what I mean? And so there was something within me that God had placed there that allowed me to really, you know, just have the ignorance of not really understanding the enormity of the situation. And so I think because of that, because I had a bit of ignorance, I just went full-fledged. And I was fortunate to be able to be – the most important thing is that I had a lot of veterans that were that allowed me to learn the game. Troy Benson, Pearson Prelo, Nate Clements, Terrence McGee, a lot of guys that I saw do things the right way. And I, one thing I have learned is that learn as much as I can from the people who have done it the right way and for a long time. And so being an undrafted free agent, I didn't come with any expectations. I just came really open and willing to learn. And I think that that is something that I take with me wherever I go. Wherever I start, I look to people that have done it at a high level, and I just sit and I learn from them, and I soak it up. And I think because of that, I was able to see myself in their position and to imagine myself in a – I could never imagine myself in this position, but I think that I imagine myself being a player that they would have to pull off the field. I wasn't going to give it to them easy. And so – it was an incredible journey being an undrafted free agent. You know, I would have appreciated taking a little bit more money up front, you know, like being drafted and having some of that money up front. But, you know, we all have our own journey. And I think that to embrace my own journey is something that is that has been good for me.
Jabari, can you summarize your Saints career? Because DA basically said in you they found the player, the cornerback,
Yes. So one thing that was beautiful about, you know, what Greg Williams was really building here is a defense that would be very fluid in the middle and very aggressive in the middle, and two guys he told us we're on the Audubon in at the on the edges. So me and Tracy were basically in zero man-to-man coverage almost every play, you know. And so to be able, there's a challenge. First of all, there's an extreme fear to that. I don't know if y'all have ever like been on an island in front of 85,000 people, but you know, the fear of like getting burnt in front of your family is real, you know. And so when you are there and the nearest person to you is 10 yards inside of you, and you have one of the world's best athletes running at you full speed, it can be challenging. And so it was really important for me to be an expert on technique, because what DA was saying, he was saying very eloquently that I didn't have, you know, that I don't have the you know, all the intent, all the size and all the speed that a player would, you know, that a coach would want. But I definitely had what I had, and I made sure that I maximized that to Billy. So to answer your question, I think my career was summarized by someone who understood that to be a player that they could count on, I had to understand that my part was someone who was going to lock down that corner. I mean, that was going to lock down that receiver one-to-one, and also was going to be someone that could talk to a younger player, someone who was going to be a positive influence in the locker room, somebody who was going to alleviate some of the burdens from our coaches and some of the older players in the meeting room. So I do understand as a player, it's not just about competing on the field, but it's about the man that I show up as in the locker room, in the training room, in the cafeteria, because as a young player, ultimately those coaches are going to ask, hey, what do you think about Jabari? And the way that they vouch for me, the way that they speak up for me, the way that they talk about my character may be the difference between, you know, Jabari being on this roster or Jabari being at home. And so I wanted to play not only the game inside of the lines, but I wanted to present myself as the man that I am outside of the lines as well. Oh yeah. Oh, so I think that there's only a few places in the NFL that you have the experience that a that you have the experience with the fans that you have here in New Orleans. There's only about two or three more places. But I think that there's no place that loves and that stays with their team, no matter good or bad, than the New Orleans Saints fans. And I believe that because of that, I was able to not only fall in love with the fan base, but fall in love with the city. I remember in 2011 when we came so close. You know, we had a really good team, and unfortunately, we weren't able to get to the NFC Championship. And I remember coming home from San Francisco, and the streets were lined with thousands and thousands of fans, like loving us, encouraging us, being there for us, whether win or lose. And there's many times in which we walked out the tunnel after a tough loss in the Superdome, and people were encouraging us just as if we had won the game, picking up our heads, not ever giving up on us. And so I do understand that we had set a standard of winning and of excellence from that 2009 to 2011 season. People were expecting us to be to hold a certain standard. But when we did not meet up to that standard, every single week we were met with grace. We were met with understanding. And I think that you only get that in a city that sees itself in its team. The way that the New Orleans Saints embraces diversity, they embrace community, they embrace family, you know, I think it permeates throughout the city. This is a city that loves its people. This is a city that loves its people. And because they love its people so well, they love their team. These people love their team. And I think that in turn, the teams love the community. I could not have been, I could, like, through God's grace, I came to the best place on earth to play football. And there was no place like the Superdome on Sunday. You're hearing the brass band. You're hearing stand up get crunk for the first time. You know, those are moments that you can't replicate. And to be on the center stage, to be on the center stage in front of 85,000, 90,000 people when stand up get crunk on, when stand up and get crunk comes on, and everybody's going crazy so much where I can't even hear the guy next to me, is something that was so special. And I feel like that you can only get here, that you can only get here. And so, I mean, for me, this became home, and it's still home. My children were born here. You know, we have New Orleans circulating through our blood, you know, and the way, I think it was just a definitive point in my life where everything changed. It's kind of like post-New Orleans, you know, pre-New Orleans or post-New Orleans for me, you know. And so, yeah, the relationship between the team and the fans is one that's special. And for me in particular, I think that this is one of the best places on earth. I love New Orleans. And because New Orleans has loved me so well. Yes, sir.
Talk about your high and low moments as a New Orleans Saint.
Oh, okay, great. So I've told this story plenty of times, and I know that. The best moment that I would say would be obviously 2009. So we worked so hard to make the playoffs and make the Super Bowl. We finally get there and we win it. Right? We win the game, and all my family comes down. They come down. My mom's there. My brother's there. My wife's there. My newborn son and my older my daughter was 6 at the moment, and my son was 5, and we had a 17-month-old, and she was pregnant with my other son. The confetti's coming down, and I remember at that moment where I was at 6 years old. I was up, staying up late, way past my bedtime. I know my mom probably don't, you know, probably don't realize this, but I'm up, in have a TV in my room. I'm staying up late past my bedtime, and I'm seeing the New York Giants. They play, I think it was the Buffalo Bills, New York Giants game. I'm seeing the confetti falling, and I'm in my room, and I'm like, man, that looks incredible. Fast forward 20-something years, and now my children are there at the moment. The confetti's falling on their face, and I realize at that moment, like, their lives will never be the same. So it wasn't about the game. It was about this sport, this team, this opportunity, this moment has given me an opportunity to change, through God's grace, given me the opportunity to change my children's life, and then in turn, change my children's children's life. They have experiences that I've never had before. I've never been in a moment like this. And now, through God's grace, I'm able to share these things with my kids. And so that will change them, and that will change their children and their children's children. And so I think the worst moment, the most painful moment obviously was my injury. That was the most painful moment. The worst moment, I don't necessarily know what a worst. Oh, I mean, it could have been getting beat by Tom Brady deep ball the last second. Oh, yeah. You know, yeah, I know, right? Okay, so basically we're in Foxborough, and the only thing we got to do is, like, you just hold them. You know, we just got to hold them. And they, two minute warning, Tom Brady's on the field. They got two rookie wide receivers, and they just go methodically down the field, and we go cover four. We only have to hold them one more play. The clock's ticking 20-something seconds, 19 seconds, 18 seconds. Tom Brady steps back. Coach says, get deep. I get deep. He throws it over my head in the corner. Touchdown. We lose the game. I'm seeing this play over and over again. It's still going on ESPN. The play is still in repeat on ESPN. My father at that moment, it was 2013. My father at that moment was, he had been diagnosed with terminal cancer. So he was in the process of, like, transitioning. So, you know, at the moment I felt bad for my teammates. I'm like, man, I let my team down. I wish I could be, I messed up. But there was some clarity, understanding, like, you know what, I mean, it could be worse. You know, my dad's fighting for his life right now. Let me call him and, you know, cheer him up, you know. And so I remember going home and, like, picking up the phone and being like, hey, Dad, how you doing? How you doing, Daddy? My dad sat there for a minute. He said, I'm doing better than you, buddy. I'm doing better than you. I was like, oh, yeah, you're right. And I just, like, cracked up. So that was one of my worst moments, but it became, like, one of my best moments. You know what I mean? It was the epitome of my dad. And so I was like, yeah, you're probably right. So that's it.
Yeah.
We good? Thanks, guys. Oh, did you have, you good? Pleasure. Oh, okay, yeah. Awesome. Thank y'all. Okay.
Class personified. Jabari has been through a lot in his personal life, and every step of the way he was as gracious as you could possibly imagine. I had him speak at faith-based functions on a few occasions back in the day, and that's obviously a big part of his life still today, which is awesome. Of course, we have three honorees in a room I want to recognize before I introduce this year's Joe Gemelli Fleur de Lis Award recipients. This award is all about people that have contributed to the betterment of the New Orleans Saints organization over an extended period of time, and we have three of those previous honorees that are in the room today. I want to recognize Marco Garcia, the original New Orleans Saints Spanish broadcaster here today, whom we honored. I also want to recognize one of the longest tenured New Orleans Saints employees in the history of the franchise, one of the finest people you'll ever meet, from our board of directors, Barra Bercher, who's in the back of the room there. And the Saints director of administration for like 95 years now or something like that, my friend Jay Romig over here. So. We will honor Jabari, the actual induction will take place December the 8th. The actual induction is the weekend of the Carolina Panthers game, December 8th through the 10th. That's when the actual induction of these gentlemen will take place. Today's the announcement, just to clarify that for everyone. And we'll honor Jabari tonight and tomorrow. He'll be in Biloxi. He'll be speaking tonight at a reception in Biloxi, and then he'll be at a golf tournament tomorrow morning, and then throwing out a first pitch at a baseball game tomorrow night. So he's been working on his fastball. He tells me he's up to 85 or so. It's all good, man. Joe Gemelli Fleur de Lis Award, as I alluded to previously, is all about people that have contributed in some fashion to the betterment of the New Orleans Saints organization. The list of honorees is really diverse from the standpoint of what they did and what they contributed. And this year is a unique situation. We've done this on a few occasions. And our selection committee, our media guys, do a great job at identifying people who have done pretty much everything. It runs the gauntlet from guys that were on the chain gang to stat guys to people that were media people, to politicians, to people that worked in some capacity with the team, or just fans. And the guys we have here today typically would be the guys on that podium right now. They'd be the guys shooting this as we speak, because they both did such a terrific job in that capacity in covering the New Orleans Saints for the better part of a couple of decades, in the days where camera people were full-time employees and they did their work on a day-to-day basis. That was true of both of these guys. I mean, the bios, you have the information with you, but when you talk about these guys, they're kind of a tandem. But to separate them briefly, Bob Parkinson worked at WWL Television and, of course, was part of a station that was on top of the market for many years and covered the team, and they had the Saints play-by-play voice as their sports director. Jim Henderson, another one of our Fleur de Lis Award recipients, and he had the benefit of working with him. But if you talk to Jim about the camera person, he'll tell you that he was really good. But if you talk to Jim about the person, he'll tell you he was great. Mm-hmm. I think that's probably the best compliment you can pay to anyone. And we're pleased to be able to announce that he's one of our co-Joe Gemelli Fleur de Lis Award recipients this year. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you our honoree for this year, number one, Bob Parkinson. Bob?
Thank you. First, I'd like to congratulate Jabari and Steve for this honor, well-deserved. And like Jabari said, when he was talking about the fans, there is no better place to play in the Dome. I mean, it gets so loud. They can talk about Seattle all they want. No, sorry, it's the Dome. When that place is rocking, you can't hear yourself think. It's amazing. The other thing is how fast and how hard these guys hit. They are. That's the first thing you notice when you get on the field for the first time, is just how fast you guys are and how hard you get hit. And yeah, I just would go, how is this person even getting up off the ground right here? But anyway, I would like to thank the New Orleans Saints organization. I'd like to thank the Hall of Fame committee, Kenny Trahan, for this nomination and this selection. You know, us folks behind the lens, we don't get a whole lot of publicity or acknowledgement. So Jim Henderson called me and he was telling me, well, you're on this, you've just been inducted into the Saints Hall of Fame. And I think most of you guys might know that he has a wicked sense of humor. And I'm just like, okay, where's he going with this? You know, this is not happening. So I'm not saying much. I don't even know if I said a word. And then finally he was like, kept saying it over and over, and I'm like, Jim, what's going on? And I heard the room applaud, and then I couldn't speak because I was speechless. So it's really a great award. I worked for Channel 4 for about 30 years. 20 was in sports. I got taken out when Katrina hit. You got to remember, we were still thinking, being reminded of the Ditka era, and people would come up to me and they, you're out of sports? And I go, yeah, thanks to Katrina. And everybody would say, well, you know, you covered the disasters every Sunday in the fall, so you'll be in your element. but I'd also be remiss if I didn't mention all the great people that I worked with at Channel 4, starting with Jim, obviously, but Mike Haas, who's now the play-by-play guy for the Saints. Juan Kincaid's over at Channel 8. Mike Schaefer's in charge of Channel 8. Lee Zurich's over at Channel 8. It seems like everyone at Channel 4 is now over at Channel 8. And I don't want to leave anybody out. We had Tom Planchet, great producer. Mike Schaefer was a producer. Brent Ledet and Joe Friesard, just wonderful human beings. I couldn't have gotten anywhere close to where I got if I hadn't had those people having my back. So I'd just like to say it's been a great honor. something I never believed would happen. Was shocked when I got the word. Still kind of shocked, but thank you.
Any questions for Parky?
Good.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Slide it. I'll get it. Our other Joe Gemelli Fleur de Lis Award recipient is, of course, a peer of Bob's, and they were side by side on many occasions. He can't hear a word I'm saying, so I can say anything I want about him right now. So that's him. We joke about that frequently, but hearing's not his best suit. That said, probably the best thing I could say about him was he had the funniest collage of Jim Mora colloquialisms that has ever existed, and all of our friends in the media that covered the team know this. He probably still has it, and it was incredible because it was one of the best pieces of editing I've ever seen. And anybody that was here when Mora was here understood exactly what I'm talking about. It was really funny. But, of course, he worked alongside some legends of his own right, like Buddy DiLiberto and Ed Daniels, who's here today, and Roe Brown, who's here today, among others. And all these guys are part of the selection committee, and they deeply appreciate what he accomplished as well. And he's born and raised a Nichols Bobcat and, of course, a University of New Orleans privateer. And I know he's been really happy to be able to do this in his hometown for all these years as well, and was happy to be behind the camera shooting so many memorable moments and some forgettable moments in New Orleans Saints history. So with that, I give you our other Joe Gemelli Fleur de Lis Award recipient, Steve Paretti. Steve?
Well, I wasn't prepared to say anything because he told me, you're not going to have to say anything. Don't worry about it. Just sit there. So, and if it would have been last night, I wouldn't have said anything because I lost my voice yesterday. So that would have been good for today. I wouldn't have had to say anything. But anyway, I want to thank everybody for coming today and those that voted us in this for this award, because this guy was one of the reasons why I was better at what I did, because I would always follow him to see what the hell is he doing. If I didn't see Bob somewhere, I said, he's up to something. I better look for him. So I'd find him all kind of places, getting the dunk on the coach and all that kind of. He always could work his way into the bench, and I always got spotted and got pulled out by the state police. But anyway, I worked with Buddy DiLiberto, got me into this, and I bugged him for a long time to do it. And I worked at the Picayune, and I used to give him race results, and I wasn't supposed to. And I worked there for 7 years, and Rossler would always tell me, Paretti, don't give DiLiberto the damn race results. So I was trying to get Buddy to like me. So I'd go back in the wire room, pull the race results on the other side of the paper and read them to him, you know. And he had all these crazy spots like Calder, Thistle Downs. I never even heard of these tracks before. So anyway, he gave me a start. He said, if you can get 6 months in TV somewhere, I can get you in. So I went to Lafayette and worked there for a while, and then I came back to New Orleans. And he got me in, and I worked there in sports for 22 years. And I worked with Ed and Roe and Vince Marinello, and it was a very interesting department, let me tell you that. Working just with Buddy was enough, but with these two guys, I used to love to bug Ed, and he still hates me today for the stuff I used to do for him. I hope he still loves me, because I love him. I never did do it on purpose. But anyway,
you did it on purpose.
Yeah, I did. It was a great run. I mean, I saw some good things. I saw some bad things. I mean, one of the memories I have, most people would say, why would that be a memory? But it was for me. The Saints had beaten the Steelers at Three Rivers Stadium. It was 1987, and it was the first winning season. It was a guaranteed winning season. The goal line stand with the dome patrol, and it was great. And so Buddy and I rush in the locker room. We go to Dave Waymer to talk to him, and a man is sitting there crying. And I said, why are you crying? Because I get choked up when I talk about people crying. He said, man, I'm so happy for the fans. We got it. Finally got the win for them. And that was a memory. One of the things that wasn't so good was getting run over by Ronnie Lott in San Francisco. I mean, I had 6 hip surgeries. I don't know if that was the reason for it, but that brought it on, I'm sure. I mean, he slammed me into the bleachers. I mean, Eric Martin stood up and stood in front of me. The ball went over my head. I got up and bam, he nailed me. And that's not one of the better memories, but it was a great run. I got to go to the Super Bowl, but I didn't want to shoot on the field because I just had hip surgery. I said, if I get hit, I'm going to Miami General. I'm not going to make it the rest of the game. So I stayed behind because I had a tendency of getting hit. But anyway, it was a fun run, and I had some great people that I worked with. And like I said, wasn't for Buddy, I wouldn't be here today. I mean, he really helped me out. So I want to thank everybody, and it's an honor to be going in with this guy because he is something else. I mean, he's one of the best photographers I've ever run into. And he's also the best editor. You should have seen some of the stuff he had put together at training camp. It was awesome. Because we spent hours and hours at training camp.
Still got to pay you now.
And I want to thank the kids because they said you were always gone. Elizabeth told me just the other day, Dad, you were never home. You're always running with the Saints. And I would say 6 weeks at a time in La Crosse, Wisconsin for 12 years we went up there. So, we went all over the place. And so... it's memorable, and I had a great time, and that's the best part of my life. So, thank you, everybody.
Any other questions? If not, they'll be available as soon as we're done here. So, once again, the actual induction will be December the 8th at a luncheon, and then that weekend we'll have all of our events, including a gala on Saturday night, December 9th, and the game where these guys will be honored will be the Carolina Panthers game, a noon game on Sunday, December the 10th. So that's when the actual induction will take place. As mentioned, we'll be honoring Jabari tonight and tomorrow in Biloxi with about 30 of our former players that will be there, and Jeff Ireland and Doug Miller and a few others from the organization. And those are always great events with our friends on the Gulf Coast. So we look forward to that. And, of course, go to NewOrleansSaints.com, SaintsHallOfFame.com. All the information will be there as well. These gentlemen will be available to you if you'd like to speak to them, so we'll let you do that now. Otherwise, we thank you for being here on behalf of the Saints Hall of Fame, and God bless you.
Congratulations. Congratulations. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Oh, you're right.
Can we get a quick group shot?
Yeah.
Three
let's
get a group shot of the inductees group. All three of you.
I put my